Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us for this hour and the program before us. First, before we get into that, let me just share a few thoughts about an incredible human being that we just recently lost. What you can't see, but what is staring at me, is the portrait that hangs over the very desk that Joe Kernan sat behind as he guided this state. And the city of South Bend, indeed the state of Indiana, the nation, the Navy, lost a good man. We lost a trusted man, a devoted man, a loyal man, someone who taught so many so much. He had a loving toughness, a grit about him that I will never be able to relate to, and thankfully most of us won't have to, because he did. When General Douglas MacArthur talked about duty, honor, and country, the general was talking exactly about Joe Kernan, our Joe Kernan. He would always say, "Call me Joe." This was a man who you wanted in the arena to face those challenging times, a man who would say yes to good causes, no matter if it was the little leagues or the big leagues. In the cockpit of an airplane or the ship of state. And the challenges that he faced not only revealed his impeccable character, but they reminded us, inspired us, that we can all do better. I will miss that sparkle in his eye. I will miss that warm Hoosier smile and his wit, and can only think that as our state has the real honor of wishing him fair winds and following seas, that he is smiling down from that golden dome up in the sky, maybe chatting and laughing with some of his longtime friends, those who he flew through life with. And we send much love his way and to Maggie and the entire Kernan family. And with that, we have more important business to tend to, more updates to get to today. And we've got a full program. First and foremost, we'll be talking about our Back on Track executive order. Dr. Box will talk about and share some new data tools that the Department of Health will introduce in the coming days, and you'll give us some updates on testing and positivity rates that help guide us in literally every decision that we make. Dr. Dan is also with us today, and he'll give some long-term care testing updates inside those facilities. Director Fred Payne is somewhere around here. I saw him walk in, or there he is, saw him walk in earlier. Fred at the DWD will give us some updates on employment insurance and employment numbers that have come in over the last 10, 14 days. And then Jake Sipe is also back at housing under the guidance of the Lieutenant Governor. And Jake will give us an update on the progress of the CARES Act rental assistance program. There's talk ongoing now at the federal level, but we have some updates for you all as well here from the state level. We'll have that update. Lieutenant Governor and I met last night and went over some updates that I mentioned kind of in passing last week, but we'll have some updates next week on Wednesday in terms of tourism and restoration and preservation that we'll be able to roll out. I like where it's heading and want to make sure it's complete when she makes that announcement next Wednesday. So first, let me just say, in terms of our executive order, we will be staying in stage 4.5 through August 27th. I'm optimistic by nature, but I'm also optimistic about where we're heading. And with some recent requirements and recommendations, I think we can get there. I want to be safe, not sorry. So this gives us kind of that runway that we're seeing throughout the country and other states that have introduced similar requirements, bend those positivity rates down. And so we're hopeful, but we have to do everything that we can. This, what I'm reminded of on a daily basis, is this virus will take what we give it. And so it's incumbent upon us to be on our best behavior and practicing physical distancing and good hygiene and masking up when you can't put that distance between you. Dr. Box will go more into that in detail with that data that I mentioned, but our kind of persistent high positivity rate ticking up in different parts of our state has caused us to say we're gonna remain here through August 27th as it stands right now. Local governments, I always share this reminder, local governments, of course, and we support, can be more stringent if they find themselves in a situation where they wanna impose more stringent guidelines than the state is. That's their choice. We'll continue to support that. We will hear in the administration, in state government, we'll start to open up our offices beyond appointment only, beginning August 17th. So Hoosiers that need assistance between now and then, of course, can make appointments. And various state agency offices are already open, but inside the state house and the appointment only meetings that are occurring right now throughout the state, those will be ongoing. However, we are methodically putting together that plan to open up all of state government beginning on August 17th. I will also extend a couple times the moratorium on evictions from rental properties and the prohibition on filing foreclosures through August 14th. And again, Jake Sipe will touch more on this, but this is going to align with the moratorium on the disconnection of the utility services. So we're starting to seek further alignment on a lot of our dates inside the executive order. And then again, Jake will elaborate on this front. So with that, I will turn it over to Dr. Box for your weekly updates.
Thank you, Governor. Each week during this pandemic, we've presented you with data, and we've expanded on that data throughout to help keep Hoosiers informed of how COVID is impacting our state. As you've all seen lately, the number of daily positive tests being reported has increased. Today, we reported 630 additional COVID-19 cases in Indiana, which brings us to a total of 64,299, the total number of Hoosiers known to have had COVID. Over this last week, we've seen more than 6,400 new positive cases. That's roughly 10% of all the cases identified since the beginning of March. We also saw 8 additional confirmed deaths. To date, 2,733 Hoosiers have died of COVID-19, and another 199 are believed to have died from this disease based on their clinical diagnosis. Our ICU bed and ventilator capacity are holding steady, and the bulk of patients using ICU beds and ventilators are not people with COVID. There are currently 216 testing sites around the state, and we update our map daily. Through these efforts, more than 724,000 Hoosiers have been tested for COVID-19, up from more than 654,000 a week ago. We are seeing increased volume at our Optum sites and have added second teams to at least 7 of our sites. Our agreement with Optum runs through a month-to-month basis. We have committed to continue with Optum at least through August and will evaluate testing needs statewide each month to guide future decisions. We've rolled out a grant opportunity for our local health departments to encourage more testing at the local level. This testing would be in addition to Optum clinics and our ISDH-run drive-through and pop-up clinics. It would not replace them. As you know, testing capacity is a critical part of our four guiding principles for reopening. The others include our hospitalization data, our capacity to treat a surge of patients, and the ability to do contact tracing for those who test positive. Here you can see that we have had 45% of our ICU beds available as of this past Monday. We have 84% of our ventilators available statewide. More than 900 people are currently hospitalized with COVID or with symptoms of COVID. This continues to tick up, but our daily hospital admissions for COVID have dropped. We also continue to look at our positivity rate, which is the percentage of unique individuals who test positive on a given day over the percentage of tests done on unique individuals. Our current rolling 7-day average positivity rate was 6.8%, which is up from our low of 4.5% in mid-June. To help Hoosiers better understand how COVID is impacting Indiana, we are making some updates to our dashboard this week. Currently, the number of people tested reflects unique individuals. It doesn't capture people who may have had more than one COVID test. We will be adding a line to show total tests administered to reflect this and more clearly show the difference between new individuals tested and new tests. This will still reflect only PCR tests and will not include antigen or serology tests. We also will be adding the 7-day positivity rate and adding a map that shows the 7-day positivity rate by county. This will help track the prevalence of the virus in Indiana County so that we can take quick action when we spot concerning changes. Counties with positivity rates under 5% are in blue. Those with rates between 5 and 10% are in yellow. Counties between 10 and 15% are in orange, and counties above 15% are in red. We will be adding these maps to our dashboard later this week and updating those daily so that you can see where each county stands. Before I have Dr. Dan provide some updates on long-term care testing, I want to talk briefly about the importance of contact tracing. In the month of June, just over 77% of positive cases were successfully contacted. From July 1st to July 20th, nearly 80% of cases were successfully contacted. This means that we talked to a person and they either completed the initial interview or verbally refused to complete the interview. These are good percentages compared to what I'm hearing from other states. But they also mean that about 20% of people who are positive are not responding to contact tracers. Those are the people we really worry about because it means that they likely aren't taking steps that they need to protect themselves, their friends, and their family members who might also have been exposed. I cannot stress enough how invaluable contact tracing is in helping to stop the spread of COVID-19. Every Hoosier has a role to play by telling your employer, your friends or family members, and by working with contact tracers if you test positive. We've been able to mitigate the spread of COVID in a number of situations here in Indiana because people have cooperated with our contact tracers. For example, when a staffer tested positive at a church camp in southern Indiana, we were able to quickly act to determine who else was in close contact and to quarantine those individuals. 40 of the 50 camp staff from at least 8 different states wound up testing positive. But they were able to quarantine or isolate on site, and we were able to keep the campers from joining the staffers and then increasing the number of infections. This helped prevent further spread of the illness both here in Indiana and those staff members' home states. We've had at least 75 other cases traced to camps, family reunions, church events, graduation parties, bachelor parties, and weddings. At least 11 cases have been traced to 2 bachelor parties in southwestern Indiana. We suspect that there may have been more because people refused to name close contacts for many of those parties. We also have had up to 60 people exposed to a case at a prom here in the state of Indiana. These are all real-world examples and allowed us to pinpoint the source of an infection and to notify individuals so that they could protect others from COVID. Having people willing to tell us where they were and who they were with while they were ill significantly reduces the spread of COVID. So we encourage any Hoosier who gets a phone call or a text from our contact tracers to please respond. We all have a role to play in preventing COVID cases. Now it's time for Dr. Dan's update.
Thank you, Dr. Box. Thank you, Governor. I'm going to take a few minutes to discuss the preliminary long-term care data that's hyperlinked on our dashboard. We've gotten a lot of questions about this data and what they mean and why they are different from what we've previously reported. The first thing I should emphasize, and should have done so last week, is that these data are preliminary. Right? Earlier this month, we decided to build a dashboard that would provide verifiable facility-level information spanning the entire pandemic. We therefore required facilities to go back to March 1st and submit or resubmit, for some of them, their case and death data. I'll mention incidentally that on that Monday update, we added an additional 95 facilities. This is now roughly 95% of all of the facilities who have uploaded their data, and we're still working really closely with the remaining 5% to get all of them uploaded. But once they've sent the data, it doesn't stop there. Submission is really just one step. Right? After they submit, we need to verify the data accuracy. And we do this by cross-checking the information. For instance, if they send us a case that's positive, we want to look in our corresponding test databases to find a corresponding lab result. If they have a death, we want to also cross-check that with our death reporting systems. This validation process is critical for us to have accurate and reliable data, but it also takes some time. And we're not finished doing the validation process. We will be finished by the time the dashboard's released. In many ways, I think I'm just trying to remind people that the data is preliminary and is still likely to change. So one of the questions we're getting is why there's more deaths in the preliminary data file than we've previously reported on our dashboard. For one thing, facilities reporting information are now sending us more complete data. We're now asking for information that goes back to March 1st. And this has likely resulted, and sadly, in higher case and death counts. It's also likely that our improved data reporting system has made it easier and faster for facilities to get us this required information. And while I'm on the subject, I do want to emphatically put to rest a concern that's been voiced by some. We have never underreported or hid data. Right? We have always reported the aggregate data facilities submitted to us. However, the way we collected data from facilities has changed. Right? Our previous system was created to help us identify new cases in facilities so we could mobilize strike teams and infection control resources. That first system was not designed for cumulative reporting or in-depth analysis. For that, we needed to build a new system, built specifically for public reporting of facility-level information. The different numbers in these two data systems is likely also because they come from different sources, methods, and uses, and to repeat, not from us hiding or underreporting it. I think the data also show us the human impact of this pandemic, right? Not in numbers, but in lives. It is easy to get caught up in arguments around masks and data reporting and reopening, but for the Hoosiers who live and work in these long-term care facilities, this pandemic is about life and death. Right? This is why we are compelled to protect those vulnerable individuals and why we collectively do so by wearing masks, washing our hands, and socially distancing. It's for our friends, neighbors, and family who reside and work in these facilities that we as a state are working as hard and as smart as we can to prevent and mitigate COVID-19 outbreaks. It's why we began deploying strike teams back in March, why we have expanded infection preventionists around the state, and why we prioritize PPE and testing for these facilities. It's also why in the month of June, we tested all skilled nursing staff. And so let me share with you briefly the results of that initiative. In June, we tested 46,201 skilled nursing employees. This is likely in the ballpark of 80% or so of individuals who work in these facilities. Of those tested, 466 staff, or just about 1%, tested positive. Now, one of our testing goals and one of the reasons we did this initiative was to determine if there were characteristics in the facility, for instance, its size or its county location, or characteristics among the staff who work in them, whether they're dietary, direct care, et cetera, that would allow us to better target who needs testing and who needs repeat testing. Now, while the numbers did show us that staff members and facilities were more likely to have positive cases if they were in a county with a higher prevalence rate, unfortunately, the data does not give us the sufficient basis to strategically target our testing. Even in counties with prevalence rates that were less than 3%, we had facilities with significant number of staff who were positive. So because of this, and with our rising community cases, and the importance of preventing facility outbreaks, we have decided to test again nursing home staff in August. And as we did in June, we're going to work closely with the facilities to do this in a way that has the smallest impact on their continued daily operations. As our efforts go forward, we will continue to update you on cases, on testing, and what we're doing to protect nursing home residents and staff. This is what we've done from the beginning, are doing now, and will do until the end of this crisis. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Dan. Director Fred Payne, you want to come up and give us an update on our weekly UI claims? And maybe give us, if you can, just kind of pull out or break out private employment, et cetera, how that all feeds into the mix.
Okay. Thank you, Governor. Our total weekly initial unemployment claims filed in the most recent week that we released on last Thursday was 17,938. This was the first time that our initial claims amount had fallen below 20,000 since early March. That's significant. It shows good progress on where we're going. But although we've seen the initial claims drop, we'll probably see them ebb and flow from time to time. Now I'll focus a little bit on the most recent released numbers when it comes to total state unemployment, particularly for the month of June, which was the most recent month released. July's numbers will be released on August 21st. As many of you are aware, Indiana's unemployment rate stands at 11.2% for June. That's down from 12.3% in May, and that's much lower than it was in April, where it stood at 16.9%. Now, that's up quite a bit from early March, from 3.2%. We know that we're throwing around a lot of numbers, but the point behind a lot of these numbers is to show where we are, where we've come from, and the progress that we need to make. Now, specifically as it relates to Indiana's private industry, the private employment in June increased by 128,900 people from the previous month. Overall, June private employment stands at 2.5 million. That's up from 2.4 million in May. The two sectors that showed the most positive increase or the most improvement in June were leisure and hospitality and manufacturing. Our Indiana's labor force, our labor participation rate, which measures the percentage of people in our labor force, stands at 64.3%. That's above the national average of 61%. Now, what's key about 64% is when we compare that to what our labor participation rate was in February, which was 64.4%. So our labor participation rate is about the same right now as it was in February. Now, why is that significant? It lets us know that our Hoosiers are ready, willing, and they're energized to make sure that we bounce back from this pandemic and ready for work. I have to spend a little bit of time talking about fraud. We continue to see fraudulent claims being filed in our unemployment insurance system. Just like around the nation, whenever you have large volumes of unemployment insurance claims filed or any type of large volume of funding, you'll see some fraud. We're working with our state and our federal partners and law enforcement on addressing these issues. The attempts at fraud will ebb and flow because the fraudsters are on the prowl. As an example of this ebb and flow, in late June, we saw in 1 week our initial unemployment claims jump to 53,000. That was about a 67% increase from the previous week. That was indicia that fraud was at play and that Indiana was being targeted just like some other states. We paused claims with certain characteristics to investigate and clear them before we made any payments. Although we have internal tools to address fraud, our best resource really is our public, our employers, and individuals. If you see something, say something so we can investigate it and we can help thwart a fraud. Our fraud comes in many forms, and we're going to remain vigilant in addressing it. Now I'd like to spend a little bit of time talking about the federal $600 add-on to unemployment insurance. That federal assistance is expected to expire at the end of this month. As we stand here today, our U.S. Congress has not extended those payments. As we know, as we stand here today, they're in further discussion about that. So once we find something out, or once they make a move, if they make a move, we will let you know and we'll make sure that we adjust our system. Finally, I'd like to talk a little bit about jobs. We continue to work on education and training and connecting individuals to available jobs and to employers who are hiring, and connect employers to individuals who have the skills that they need for this environment. To connect the resources related to the Rapid Recovery Initiative, providing free or virtually free job training and employer resources, individuals may go to yournextstepin.org. Since we've kicked off this initiative, we've had over 500 new employers to get involved in our employer training grant program. And we've had many Hoosiers who are participating, are starting to participate in our free training that leads to certifications and even college credits. This is an indication again that our Hoosiers are energized and ready to continue tackling this COVID environment. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you, Fred. Jake, you want to give us an update on the assistance programs that we have and where you see that going, the number of applications, et cetera?
Sure. Thank you, Governor. I'm going to give a quick overview of the rental assistance program and an update. And then I'm also going to share some other additional resources that may be valuable to Hoosiers across our state. $25 million in Federal CARES Act funding is being used to help Hoosiers struggling to pay rent. The Indiana Housing Community Development Authority's program opened on July 13th. So far, we've received more than 20,000 applications submitted from Hoosier renters. This rental assistance program is for Hoosiers outside of Marion County. I want to remind everyone that Marion County also has their own separate rental assistance program. So now let me highlight some of the eligibility criteria for Indiana's rental assistance program. Renters may be eligible if they have lost income because of the pandemic. Applicants cannot receive rental assistance from another source of rental assistance during the same month when participating in the state's program. Renters may be eligible if they are having trouble paying rent and face eviction. Payments are sent directly to landlords on behalf of renters. Information for renters and landlords outside of Marion County may be found at indianahousingnow.org. Information for Marion County residents may be found at indyrent.org. At IHCDA, we're working with over 60 statewide community partners. We also have members of the Indiana National Guard who are assisting us with the application review process. If you are a participating landlord, you may begin to receive payments as early as next week. Applications may be found at indianahousingnow.org, where we also have one-pagers for renters and landlords. We also have a document that answers some of the most frequently asked questions that we've received, and all of these documents are in English and in Spanish. Now, I also want to talk about Indiana's Foreclosure Prevention Network, which helps Indiana homeowners who have fallen behind on mortgage payments or cannot make future payments. If you're in this situation, please go to 877-GET-HOPE.org, or you can call 877-285-0401. Now, I would recommend that you go to 877-GET-HOPE.org because we also have some frequently asked questions that we've answered, and you can also begin the application process at 877-GET-HOPE.org. Lastly, I want to talk about the Energy Assistance Program, which is available for renters and homeowners who have lost income because of the pandemic. This is a federal program that helps Hoosiers with their home energy cost. Now, it's important to know that the application deadline to apply is this Friday, July 31st. Now, more information is available at eap.ihcda.in.gov or by calling 211 and ask for your local service provider of the Energy Assistance Program. Governor, that's my updates on our rental assistance program, our mortgage assistance program, and our utility assistance program.
Perfect. Don't go far.
Okay.
just to put something in perspective that Jake and both Fred touched on, Jake, you used the word hope. My cup overfloweth with hope, but there's also a lot of opportunity out there. And to put it all into perspective, when we look at all the new jobs that are coming to our state, even this year, and we've announced some most recently, but we're now at new job commitments, just under 16,000 new job commitments coming through the Indiana Economic Development Corporation, so 15,900 some. To put that in perspective, in 2016, we were just over 20,000. So we're going to have a new job commitment year like we had in 2016 on top of those jobs that if you go to Fred's shop, whether it be at Indiana Career Connect or Next Level Jobs to get the skills that you need to fill all those 90-some thousand jobs that are out there and posted. There's not just hope out there. There is real opportunity. And that's how we'll rebound even quicker when folks understand that there are careers out there, not just jobs, but careers out there that we think you might be passionate about. So those tools are there. We're going to continue to make sure that everyone knows and has awareness how to access your end goal. And with that, Rachel, we'll go right to the Q&A.
Hope with the State House file.
Speaking of hope.
Good afternoon, Governor. So my question is, communities across Indiana are canceling events planned for the fall and early winter, from the Irvington Halloween Festival to the Christmas Market in Carmel, because of COVID-19. So why isn't the state making provisions to allow Hoosiers to vote by absentee ballot without needing an excuse on November 3rd? Won't making a decision at the last minute create some of the chaos that we saw in June? And aren't you putting Hoosiers at risk expecting them to vote in person, especially when counties may not have enough people to staff polls adequately?
Yeah, no, I don't think so. I think you're equating two different scenarios. Number one, when we delayed an election to June 2nd, almost a full month from the time, we were contemplating and didn't know how long we would be sheltered in place or staying at home or hunkered down. Now Hoosiers can go out. Now you can vote almost a month in advance from that final in-person election day voting. And there are various options if you can't vote in person over a month-long period. You have those options as well.
Tom Davies, The Associated Press.
Afternoon, Tom.
Hello, Governor. What guidance are you giving to school districts as they're trying to make their reopening decisions now, as their actions are all over the board right now? And shouldn't there be some statewide benchmarks And I have another stool question if I could ask that after your answer.
You want to launch right into that hour sure. of response?
Sure. So we have been giving a lot of guidance to schools through our webinars and to our local public health professionals through the local health department webinars. I've met and spoken with many superintendents. The governor and I talk with the Indiana State Teachers Association. We have been actively and proactively engaging our schools. We have talked a lot about the things that they can do to make return to school the safest return possible by cohorting students, by making sure that they have assigned seats, by assigning seats on buses, by making sure that they do their best to socially distance them, by adding masks in for those individuals that are third grade through 12th grade. And recommending that even on the playground they cohort. So we have been very actively engaged with them. I think that, you know, people want a specific, well, there has to be this percent positivity or this percent number of cases or this, or we won't open or this percent or we have to close. And realistically, that does vary a lot depending on which county we are in and what those high numbers are from. The percent positivity, for instance, can be very high because we tested only 10 people in that county and they were all sick and 8 of them came back positive, and that would look like a county that really should not be open maybe for school. But realistically, when you look at the number of people tested per 1,000 Hoosiers, it's just not enough. So there are a lot of things that go into that factor, so to say this is a specific number that we're going to use is really not appropriate. And again, schools are really actively engaged in deciding what is safest and best for their students and when to open.
And you've hired Lori.
Oh yeah, Lori Ramsey is very actively engaged with all of the superintendents and teachers and the school nurses across our state.
Yeah, and we've been impressed reviewing Dr. Sullivan, Dr. Box, Lori, everyone involved in this, and the DOE, very impressed with the plans and protocol and access to resources to reopen schools safely, some of which are in today. Tom, you said you had a follow-up or a second question?
Yes, the other one is, as the schools are struggling with these decisions, are you going to have a statewide collection of cases amongst students and staff, and will that information be available so parents and others can be aware and track what's happening?
You follow that?
We are. We are definitely aware of that request. Many people have asked that, and we are in the process right now of looking at that and investigating that further.
Adam with WTIU.
Afternoon, Adam.
Adam, you should be able to speak. We'll come back to Adam. Eric Berman, WIBC.
Afternoon, Eric.
Afternoon, Governor. I wanted to ask you about the White House Coronavirus Task Force report, which came out on Sunday, which recommends that Indiana should close the bars again. We're at 7%, Kentucky's at 7.9%, and Governor Beshear just did exactly that. Is that difference in the positivity rate enough for us to go a different route, or is there another reason why that's not a restriction we're reimposing?
It's not yet. You want to elaborate on that, and I'll follow up.
Sure. So we have had discussions. We are at about 6.8%, higher than we want to be right now as a state. There are definitely different counties that are higher than that and have taken different actions, which is a local level decision, and I think oftentimes a good decision. I think that some of the decisions that I've heard kicked around are, you know, to kind of have set number of tables and table service, and those tables are socially distanced, and otherwise maybe a lot of the bar activity is outside on the street in the open where we know that there's decreased risk for infection and transmission there. So certainly those are discussions that are occurring every day with counties depending on their particular circumstance.
Yeah, and I will say, Eric, in talking to Dr. Burks last week, she did mention other state scenarios around the country, including masks, and no matter how inartfully maybe I articulated the importance of local education and enforcement in terms of bending down that curve, that's exactly what our intent is here, and that's why you see us moving toward sharing as much information as we can on a county-by-county basis so that that can be stressed on the ground with our help to bend down that curve. And once we do that over the whole state, but like I said, this virus will take what you give it, or take what we give it. And you can't let your guard down. And the examples that you listed, whether it's a bar, for every 10 that are doing the right thing, if one doesn't enforce these guidelines at the local level, at the individual business or social gathering, it can ruin it for a much greater area. And so that's why we're working with county by county, with our local partners, to make sure that we bend it down. We think we can before we have to go there, but that's really where the enforcement comes in, is if we have to determine a county or a region of the state has to go back to a different stage. We're not there yet. And I think we can get there, and I shared this with Dr. Burks, and you heard from the Assistant Secretary of Health yesterday, I guess, Admiral Brett Garrar, who said that we were doing a number of things right, including testing, and you talked about tracing. All these are important. They're all part of the successful recipe to bend down that curve. But our actions will also have an effect on that. So physical distancing, masking up, good hygiene. We think we can get there with good enforcement on the ground with the guidelines that are there right now. We'll see where we are tomorrow and next week and next month.
Allison with ABC 57 News.
Good afternoon, Allison.
Good afternoon. Can you guys hear me okay?
Perfectly.
Wonderful. So my question, it's on a little bit of a different route, but it's in regards to Joe Kernan. My question to you, Governor, is how did Joe as governor set you up for success as governor and inspire you?
Oh, yeah. Let me count the ways. First of all, his example and how he lived his life, his fearless attitude to be a positive force for good, his genuine acceptance of people of all walks, his keen sense of building a team, his focus. I said his grit and wit. That's a pretty powerful combination. And to have a guy like Joe Kernan, who always said, call me Joe, who was so approachable, who could have done a million other things in life and excelled at them all, chose to serve in so many different places and stages in his life. And to always answer the call, even in retirement, to come back and take on some really thorny, controversial issues. A guy that I used to work for, one of my predecessors who called and said, hey, I got a real easy topic. This is Governor Daniels. I got a real easy topic for you to deal with. Would you and Randy Shepard and others head up Government Reform Commission? And he said yes, when it would have been very easy for him to not just watch, but own a baseball team and do what he loved. But he kept giving back and kept giving back. And he was just a guy that there are so many different chapters in his life, each of which are lessons that if you pay attention, we'd all be well served just following in his footsteps.
Brandon Smith, Indiana Public Broadcasting.
Afternoon, Brandon.
Afternoon, Governor. I got a couple questions. The first, they're both about the eviction moratorium.
Okay.
So you've now aligned it with the utility shutoffs moratorium.
Yep.
On August 14th. Do you anticipate then that this will be the last extension?
Too early to say, and that decision has not been made. I'm not being coy or clever in my answer here. We do want to make sure, however, and Jake, you might want to weigh in on this. We do want to make sure, however, in the next couple weeks here, that folks are making payment plans. Folks who are eligible for this help get the help, We may end up moving more resources, financial resources, for those who need it over the course of the next 2 weeks. We're still determining that. You're still looking at those figures and the demand, the need. But in addition to that, we've got to get some plans in place for the scenario that we all are going back and understanding that this is a two-way street. We got to work together, and we'll be able to assist on that. There will also be some other, and I hope by next week, Brandon, we're able to be more clear about this, but some other mediation assistance that will come to bear on this front as well.
Yeah. Thank you, Governor. If you are a renter and you are behind, first thing to do is to reach out to your landlord and to try to work out a payment plan. That goes with home ownership as well. Reach out to your mortgage loan service provider and try to work out some type of payment plan to bring yourself current. We've had a lot of conversations with a lot of our utility companies, and we do know that there are folks that are also behind on their utilities. We're not seeing that also with our renters and our homeowners who are trying to work with local utility providers in getting on those payment plans, because they're also offering those, and many of them also offer other programs to assist. And we're seeing that across our state where there's other housing assistance that's being provided through some of our community foundations, some of our not-for-profits and our trustees that also provide assistance with rental and home ownership and utility assistance. And so there is assistance out there beyond just what IHCDA and the state of Indiana may provide, and a lot of that is at the local level. A lot of that, though, does require homeowners and renters to work closely with your landlord and your mortgage provider and your utility service provider to make sure that you're on that understanding of how you're going to get yourself current. We know there's a lot of that going on the rental side, working with the Indiana Apartment Association. We're not seeing that on the utility side, and I'm not sure why, but it's there, and I would encourage renters and homeowners to make sure that you're engaged and having conversations. IHCDA created a eviction and foreclosure prevention guide to help renters and homeowners have that conversation with your landlord and your mortgage service provider and your utility provider as well.
Thanks, Jake. Brandon, you said you had a second question?
Yeah, just about this, a quick follow-up on it. There was a lawsuit filed in federal court just recently about your eviction moratorium. How will that sort of impact your decision-making as you think about possible extensions in the future?
It won't. Not to be flip, but it just won't. We'll follow up on our own convictions. I won't live under the threat of a lawsuit. We feel very comfortable about where we are right now and where we can go under the law.
We'll return to Adam with WTIU.
Afternoon, Adam.
Hey, good afternoon, Governor. Hope you guys can hear me okay. On the issue of masks, do you think, Governor, that it sends a mixed signal to Hoosiers when there's an executive order to require masks, but that it won't be enforced? And also, why do you think there's such a resistance, not just in Indiana, but just around the country, that wearing a mask is more of an inconvenience than stopping at a red light or a stop sign?
Well, I think with a global pandemic, the pain or hassle or inconvenience of wearing a mask pales in comparison to the pain or inconvenience or hassle it may cause by not wearing one. And however, having said that, to be charitable here, this is somewhat of a new phenomenon in our nation. There are a lot of countries around the world who have just been doing this because of particulate matter in the air. And they're more accustomed to this. This was very abrupt. And we live in a country where we love our liberty and freedom, as do I. I wish there was some kind of invisible mask that we didn't have to wear if we were. I brought Adam my tape measure to make sure, you know, not that I'm Howard Hughes and have a version to, you know, germs, but this is, you got to take this seriously. And because it's taking us, comma, seriously. And, I think about this all the time, and I remember this song back in the 80s by Thomas Dolby called Blinded by Science, and this is just science to me. And we have to do everything we can. If look, our economy will grow proportionately to our health indicators. And we're doing a pretty darn good job right now, by and large, of managing our way through this. And that's why I say I'm cautiously optimistic. The more people that are buying into this, Adam, the faster and swifter and safer we'll get through this. And there will be loss along the way. It causes my heart to ache, but we know that the more of us that buy into this now, we see it in Phoenix. We see it in other parts of not just our country, but other parts of the world. But to answer your question directly, it's just a different ask for most Hoosiers / Americans to mask up, but it makes a big difference.
Lindsay Erdody, the Indianapolis Business Journal.
Afternoon, Lindsay.
Good afternoon, Governor. Kind of following up on Brandon's question about housing, it sounded like you'd be willing to expand that $25 million program if it came to it. But I just wanted to confirm that, you know, what happens when the money runs out, but applications still haven't been addressed? And then I also have a question about the nursing homes. I'm curious, you know, why is the state still not testing all of the residents, especially since visits are allowed to a certain extent right now, and you're going back in and testing staff again?
Sure. Dr. Dan, you may want to step up to the batter's box. In terms of your first question, yes, I will confirm that we will contemplate and have or will find the resources necessary to meet that need. These are some of the many reasons why we're very prudent about where we're allocating dollars and our resources, because of these exact kind of scenarios. This is exactly why we've also, indirectly, but why we also have sought from our federal partners more flexibility, more liability protection for our schools and our businesses to go back, more sustainability. And of course, we'll be very accountable, very transparent about where these dollars are being allocated. But this is exactly one of those examples of where we want to be in the position to where we can help people that need the help.
The second question, in terms of testing residents, we from the beginning have put a focus on testing residents. I think one of the things to keep in mind is that the priority in testing staff is a preventative measure on how do you identify folks before they come to work who might have COVID and therefore might cause an outbreak. Our focus in the beginning around staff has been when there is a staff who is positive, how do we make sure we test every resident that person has been in contact with, or everyone in the facility, so that we can quickly identify those who might have been exposed and appropriately cohort them. So we have, from the very beginning, put a focus and a priority on really large-scale testing of residents in facilities where there are outbreaks.
Thank you.
Rob Burgess, the Wabash Plain Dealer.
Rob, good afternoon.
Afternoon, Governor. Appreciate the Thomas Dolby reference.
I don't know where that came from.
Governor, your executive orders have stipulated that local governments may impose stricter restrictions, but not less restrictive ones. And I know you said Lieutenant Governor Crouch and yourself are going to discuss this further in the near future. But at last Monday's Wabash County Council meeting, several members discussed writing you an open letter of protest. They expressed their frustration with state restrictions, which have contributed to a series of local events being canceled. Their basic arguments were, we have a relatively low number of cases compared to other parts of the state, and we're having to look at tightening our budgets due to the hit to our economy, especially tourism. What's your response to their concerns?
Well, I understand their protest. I understand their perspective. I understand, and I hope that folks can understand where we're coming from is responding to this pandemic and making sure that Wabash County stays relatively. I need to look at my chart here. But what we've learned is the community spread can be at one level one day and turn very quickly the next. And it's when you let your guard down and you're not vigilant that it can take a real turn. And so, yes, we're in rocky, shallow water right now as we navigate through it. However, having said that, large gatherings without the recommended guidance that you've provided, we've provided. We know where that leads to. We've seen the movie. And that's where, by the time you get to hospitalization rates going like this, it's too late. Or by the time you get to the death rates spiking up, it's too late. The community spread's already there. Then you got to ratchet down. So what we're trying to do is keep this at a manageable level and smartly, safely reopen. You want to add anything?
Yeah, Wabash is not in trouble, but they do have a 6% positivity rate. So it's higher than the 5%. And when we look at it is, as you say, we would like to be able to continue to have the economy that we have and continue to be open and continue to function in the way that we are. And so we need to use the things that we can, such as our masks, such as the social distancing, decreasing the number of people in a restaurant or in a bar at a time. And those are all things that we know will decrease the spread and transmission of this virus.
Yeah, and I'll say, Rob, that just to follow up, Lieutenant Governor Crouch, we'll be here next week on Wednesday, and this is exactly when you talk about those cultural events, those festivals, those fairs, those charitable organizations that do so much good throughout the whole year off of one event or two events that draw big social gatherings that are built on that model, like moths to a flame. That's just not the world that we live in right now. And so we're looking at making sure we can divert or allocate resources to help communities like Wabash County and 91 others, for that matter, get through this storm.
Dustin Grove, WTHR.
Good afternoon, Dustin.
Dustin, you have to unmute your own microphone.
All right, here I am. My question is about the amount of time it takes to get test results. I believe, Dr. Box, it was you who had previously mentioned you were trying to speed up the response time by working with local labs. I'm wondering, is that happening and are you seeing results?
That's a great question. We actually did see a decrease in our time with even our Optum labs. Optum, we had asked them to transition to LabCorp because there are two LabCorp labs here in the state of Indiana, thinking that was going to increase and improve our turnaround times even, you know, beyond the 48 hours, even better than where we were. We had about 93% reporting at 48 hours. Early in the course of Optum, and what we found was that with all of the other southern states becoming more of an issue, that LabCorp got very bogged down and our times went very, very long. We were going to 55 hours or more for turnaround time. We're back down now to about 42 hours of turnaround time, with about 75% of those tests being completed in under 48 hours, but we went back to using their lab that they use in Wisconsin, which is called Exact Science. So it's a daily thing where we can get the tests in. You know, can IU them run them for us quickly? Can Deaconess run it? Can our own lab at the Indiana State Department of Health, can we get them sent to Exact Science? We are juggling this every single day to try to make sure that turnaround time is as low as possible.
Every day she is hustling, okay? Every day.
Our final question is from Natalie with Wayne TV.
Yep. Natalie, good afternoon.
Hi. In an interview with Good Morning America, Dr. Fauci said the Midwest could be primed for a surge in coronavirus cases and warned states to be really careful, but he added that states can prevent surges if the guidelines are followed. Dr. Box, are you seeing similar data that would suggest an indication of a surge? And are you confident that the state is in a good place to prevent it?
I think that we are nowhere near what we see in Florida, Arizona, Texas, and other places. But because we did see an uptick, not only in our hospital admissions, but in our percent positivity and our number of positive cases, that's why we stayed in 4.5. That's why we've done the mask mandate. That's why we're trying to be very careful now so that we don't end up back in that same situation where our hospitals are overloaded with patients. So we saw warning signs of that, and if we let our guard down, we will be there. So I think Dr. Fauci, Dr. Birx, they're right to call us out on this situation, but we're keeping on top of that, and that's why we've instituted the changes that we have.
Thank you for joining today's briefing. Governor Holcomb's next briefing is next Wednesday at 2:30 p.m. Eastern.